Hey, hey, all you mentees, this is the Uncanny Omar from Near Mint Condition, and join me today for an advanced look at the X-Men by Chris Claremont and Jim Lee, Omnibus Volume 2 from Marvel Comics. Let's get started. Alright, before getting started, a huge thank you to David Gabriel and the folks at Marvel for sending us an advanced copy of this Omnibus. This Omnibus is due out in the direct market on March 10th, and then a couple of weeks later in the book market. Now, the date could change, but I'm pretty sure this one's on time. This one will make it on March 10th. Now, what we're looking at here is the direct market cover, and on your left is the standard edition cover. Both drawn by Jim Lee. One is actually the full page, and this one here is the widescreen shot from X-Men 275, one of the best issues collected in here. So, let's do a quick comparison, an external comparison rather, with the original printing. All right, let's see what difference a decade makes. On your left-hand side is my original printing of the direct market cover, because it did have two covers then too, and on the right is the new printing. Only difference I see here is just literally the little trademark logo up here. It's missing from the new printing. Colors all look the same, vibrant, beautiful. I know some people don't like when comic book art is recolored, but I really enjoyed this. I think this is a beautiful piece of artwork. Now, looking at the spines, we have the Magneto from the very first issue of Adjectiveless X-Men. And then the picture down here on the new printing is a shot from the Shattershot Annual Number 1, or X-Men Annual Number 1, which is not collected in here, but it is a Jim Lee piece of art, and it does show like a lot of the team, so that's probably why they used it. In the back, you have the exact same blurb and almost looks like the exact same font. Industry superstars Claremont and Lee take Marvel's mutants to new heights. And they did. They did. Down here at the bottom right-hand side, you see what's collected in the book. Of course, you see all the covers back there. ISBN looking a little bit smaller with the Marvel logo down there under the T for teen. And the price is the exact same price I paid for it a decade ago, $125. Now, let's look at it under the dust jacket. That, of course, is going to be different. So the original ones have this fake leather look to it, and the newer printings, it's just the logo on the actual board. This makes it look like more like a Marvel masterwork than an omnibus these days. But that's it. Now, what am I going to do with two of these? Well, of course I'm going to be giving one away. Stay tuned. We have a 40K subscriber giveaway probably the last Saturday of the month. It'll be a live Q&A and a huge giveaway. So I love to pay things forward. Let's go ahead and get started and talk about this book because we got a lot to talk about. Okay, let's open this up. We have some grayish, blackish bookend pages. I remember the original one had the marble, like a stone marble finish to it. And here we have a shot of issue number one, the cover, but with the new colors. Volume 2 of Uncanny X-Men by Chris Claremont and Jim Lee. Special thanks to all these people here, and here's your table of contents. Of course, I'm sorry, special thanks, but all the credits are here. The writers, the pencilers, the inkers, the colorists. Joe Rosa's was one of my favorite colorists growing up. But if you'll notice something here is that the writers, after Louise Simonson, after Wheezy, comes Will Sportacio and Jim Lee. That's right. By these issues, they were co-plotting the storyline. So this goes back to the days of, like, John Byrne and Terry Austin and Chris Claremont, all of them writing this story with the editors and moving forward and co-plotting the stories together. So this here is a quick synopsis of what's happened in the issues of X-Men, and then we kick off with X-Factor 63. Now, one very, very important thing, and I'll be talking more in depth about this when I do my reading order of X-Men and collected editions, but before this takes place, before these volumes take place, these issues in this volume, comes the Extinction Agenda. This takes place between X-Men by Jim Lee and Chris Claremont Volume 1 and X-Men by Jim Lee and Chris Claremont Volume 2. So there are some changes to the lineup and the team and the things that have happened within these crossover. It's also available in Milestone because I completely understand that this one's out of print, the oversized hardcover. But that does take place between both of those omnis, as well as Days of Future Present, but I'll get to that another day. So we kick off with issue 63 of X-Factor, and this collects X-Factor 63 to 70, Uncanny X-Men 273 to 280, Adjectiveless X-Men. This is the new series. This is why I call it Adjectiveless. And I'll talk a little bit more about that when we get there. And that is 1 through 11. Now, it only contains the A stories, the ones drawn by Jim Lee and plotted by Jim Lee. The other ones are contained in the Bishop's Crossing oversized hardcover. And then we also have the crossover with Ghost Rider 26 and 27. Does not contain the annual. That's part of the Shattershot oversized hardcover. Again, I'll be doing a reading order of X-Men. So, what a strange place to kick off this X-Men by Jim Lee and Chris Claremont omnibus, because these issues are not written by Jim Lee nor Chris Claremont, but they are important because they would have been orphaned had they not been included in here. This takes place after the Extinction Agenda. This is a story about Bobby and his girlfriend. Oh, at the time, what was her name? Opal Tanaka. That was her name. And her true heritage about her ties to the Yakuza and Japan. All about the, what are these guys called? The Cyber Eye, I think is what they're called. Anyway, it's about a past boyfriend that wants to get her back. And Bobby's like, no, that's my girlfriend. Yeah, I think they're called the Cyber Eye. Now, they do come back later on during Will Spertasio's run in Uncanny X-Men. But this is where they make their first appearance. And then we get to probably to me as a kid that was reading this stuff going from 7th to the 8th grade into high school, this to me was like the prime golden age of X-Men. And it is so wonderful because we kick off with issue 273. This one here is written by Chris Claremont, co-plotted by Jim Lee, and it is drawn by a bunch of artists. You have Will Spertasio, Klaus Janson, John Byrne, Rick Leonardi, Mark Silvestri, Michael Golden, Paul Smith comes back, and of course, Jim Lee. And that's not even mentioning the inkers. So here you have some Mark Silvestri, and then you have some Michael Golden artwork. There's Jim Lee's artwork. And, you know, once you get used to reading these books, you're gonna tell, oh, Larry Stroman, forgot about him. You're going to be able to tell who's who. But the important thing about this issue is this is the aftermath of the Extinction Agenda. And the teams are now together. X-Factor, the original five X-Men, and the, what I like to call, the leftovers of the Outback years. But they've all been brought back together because of Extinction Agenda. After the events of Inferno, the team started falling apart, and then this is what happens after that. The teams are finally reunited. However, Lila Cheney shows up, and she's like, hey, we gotta save Xavier! I don't know if most of y'all are familiar with who she is, but she was the teleporter from New Mutants. She was the rock star singer, intergalactic rock star singer. And here we have, man, this is the big Jim Lee co-plotting issue. This is when Jim Lee stood, like, just went from being just penciler to a guy that was like, okay, I want to start writing these stories with you, Claremont. I don't know if he called him that. Maybe he called him Mr. Claremont, Chris, whatever. But this is it. This is super sexy Magneto with super sexy Savage Land Rogue fighting against the mutates and all the people down here and Saladin and all her people. They team up with Kazar. Then that all leads into this because the X-Men are in space. They got to go rescue Xavier, who is this bad guy that's destroying everybody, the Shi'ar Empire. Now, there's a lot of plot twists and turns here. Beautiful artwork again by Jim Lee. I don't think I need to keep repeating myself, but the 275th issue, I think it won him some kind of Eagle Award, Chris Claremont. I don't know if that's for most words used on a panel or what, but I just remember reading, like, when I was a kid, I was like, man, I hope he's getting paid per word because there's a lot of words in this. Anyway, let's keep moving to the greatest saga to me that's in this book right here. And everybody's going to tell you that, yes, this is awesome because it's Jim Lee, adjectiveless X-Men. But to me, the price of admission is worth it for this particular story arc right here. And that is the endgame of X-Factor. So Apocalypse is going to take down the X-Factor team. Time and time again, they have overthrown him, and this time he's using his own ship because X-Factor at this time is using his ship as a headquarters, and he's going to turn it against them, and he has a group of new villains that are going to take down members of the X-Factor team. I love this part. This is like where Apocalypse is quizzing them, like, Gauntlet, how would you take down the Beast? Well, I would do this. Oh, it's so cool. So militant. But anyway, these are the Dark Riders to replace. He's done with the Four Horsemen during this part. Now, there are a lot of things that happen during the story arc. They go to the moon. Something happens to baby Nathan, and I'll let you find that out. I love that cover right there with the team up with Inhumans. But in issue 68 has one of the best quotes. This, by the way, is co-plotted by Jim Lee and Will Spertasio, and it is written by Chris Claremont. So to me, this is like Chris Claremont's last hurrah. But the way he writes Cyclops, this is one of the best Cyclops moments, especially the ending of issue 68. Oh, man. I can't not talk about that. All right, back to the X-Men. The X-Men are back here on Earth. And, of course, it's trouble after trouble. Oh, this is Paul Smith, if I'm not mistaken. Yep. You know, trouble always comes after the X-Men. That's always been the thing. So by the time the X-Men come back to Earth, they're on Muir Island. And, of course, Muir Island, Claremont has been setting up this storyline. Uncanny Omar talked pretty one day. Setting up the storyline for the last few years about the Shadow King taking over the inhabitants of Muir Island, including all the X-Men, all their friends. Now it's up to a newly awakened Professor Xavier to come and help out his children. Because, I mean, they are his kids. He trained them. Holy crap, I didn't realize I was going to be talking this long about X-Men. All right, of course I am. And the aftermath of that is here in the classic X-Factor number 70 when Peter David takes over the run. Now, we are going to have a Peter David X-Factor omnibus. So, issue 71 after this, in the aftermath of this, will be collected in that omnibus. But X-Men gets reborn. This is when the team split into two. We have the gold team, which is Uncanny X-Men, and we have the blue team, which is what I call adjectiveless X-Men, or because there is no Uncanny, and they started the number over at 1, whereas Uncanny continued with 281. Now, those issues are not collected in here, but they are collected in the Bishop's Crossing oversized hardcover. There were 4 different variant covers for this, and of course, they all lined up, and then there was a 5th director's cut. Like, they were way ahead of their time. This is the best-selling comic book of all time. And this leads into the final 3 issues of Chris Claremont with the return of Magneto. And he has a brand new band of followers called the Acolytes. And they fight the X-Men. There's all these beautiful pinups are in the back of issue number 1 with the villains. And I think there's a Things to Come, if I'm not mistaken, poster. Yeah, I always loved looking at this when I was a kid. Apparently, the Black Queen was supposed to come in. I don't know who that's supposed to be, because guess what? Jim Lee left after issue 11. So, we never got to find out. Sketches, this awesome poster here of all the teams, including Excalibur, X-Factor. And he gets to wrap up his run. Now, Chris Claremont leaves. That means Jim Lee steps up as the main plotter. And we have John Byrne for a little bit. And then we have Scott Lobdell come in as the dialogue. So, those are ones that... Right? Oh, my gosh! Do you all know how many times I drew this picture as a kid over and over again? Woo! Where the hell was I? In between these issues, we're told to also, you gotta read Bishop's Crossing, because that's where Bishop's introduced in the pages of Uncanny X-Men. Psylocke, man. Alright, there's a crossover here with Ghost Rider. And then... we haven't seen Longshot and Dazzler for a long time, since the Outback years, since they broke up and disappeared. So this is their big return, and it has ties to somebody from X-Force, and I'll let you find out what that is. But it's also the return of Mojo, and that's where Jim Lee ends up ending his run with issue 11. It's the last story in here. Now let's look in the extras here in the back, and then we'll do a quick comparison, because I think I've gone on long enough about X-Men. Oh man, I know some of y'all want me to do a breakdown of each issue, and it would be really fun. It would just take forever to film, because I'd be down here talking for hours and then lose my voice. Then I couldn't do any more videos. There's a lot of posters in here. I can't wait for some of you, like all of you, not some of you. Oh my gosh! I used to have this poster on my wall for a couple of years. I think I told this story recently when I was doing Met My Ex with my friends. That segment that we do on our show, I said I had this on my wall until I had a girl over in the 8th grade, and I had to take it down because I thought she was going to make fun of me. Yeah. You know, that's the difference between Omar back then and Omar in his 40s. Omar in his 40s wouldn't give a damn. He'd have that hanging up right now. Of course, he's married. Even if I wasn't married, I don't care. Ain't no girl going to judge me. There's a shatter shot. Oh, there's also covers here that he did for Uncanny X-Men. This is the second printing. This is the final issue that I was talking about. Always love that. Oh, man. There's some beautiful pieces of art in here. All the trading cards are in here that Jim Lee worked on, and I heard they're pretty hot these days. Let's keep going. All of the trading cards. I'm not exaggerating. The trade paperback cover. More trade paperback covers. And the coolest thing is at the very end, you have these really thick pages, and why is that? Oh, my God. Gotta zoom out a little bit to do it justice, but this is one side. This is the recolored side, or at what is known as the X-Men 2.0, when they went back and recolored the... It was a hardcover, I think. Love those colors. I know some people didn't. But in case you didn't, on the opposite side of that is the original colors by Joe Rosas. So there you go. And the same thing with the poster with all the teams. The recolored side, and on the opposite side, the original colors here. All right, let's take a look at this binding and then do a comparison, because that's the big important thing. Now, this omnibus has 832 pages and retails for $125. And here is your eye. So it is sewn binding. But let's do a comparison with the original printing. All right, here comes the comparison. At the top is the original printing, and at the bottom is the new printing. The differences that I see here are that the colors are a lot darker in the original printing. By the way, we're looking at pages 2 and 3, literally. So this is the very beginning. This is how the books lay over. But what I noticed is just the colors are a lot darker up here. I'm not necessarily saying that's better. I'm just noticing that they're a lot darker. So we're looking at issue 275 here because it's a double page spread. Yeah, and it was an Eagle Award winner. That was right. I thought I remember that right. By now, the colors look identical. Maybe a little bit darker here at the top. Not so much at the bottom. It's a little bit lighter. But really no other difference. This is how the books are laying over. A little bit of gutter loss here. But then again, there's a little bit of gutter loss there with Psylocke's face in the original printing. Less so up here, though, than down here. At least up here you get her ear on the right-hand side. Over here you really don't. It's lost in there. Maybe that's why they decided to use this image as the cover of the direct market. All right, let's keep going. Okay, so it does look like the colors are a little bit darker on the original printing than the new printing. Here is what this spread page looks like. So you can kind of get an idea of what it looked like in the original here, and then in the new printing and the way the books lay over. Here's this amazing image here of the X-Men just hanging out by the poolside. Wish you were here. All right, so just a comparison of Rogue's face right there. You have to hold it down a little bit on both of them. But honestly, that's about the only part that I see a gutter loss. Yeah, you could say Henry's arm, but both of them are exactly the same in both printings. All right, at least to me, it looks like the newer printing is laying over better, at least with these pages right here. And I wanted to pick these next pages because not only are they double page spreads, but they're also an iconic part of the X-Men history. The formation of the blue and gold team happens in this issue right here. And yes, all of this takes place before Uncanny X-Men 281. But here's what the spreads look like. Okay, let's look in the back at the extras, because I don't think there's any differences there. And of course, my copy up here has been read many times. So, probably why it's laying... should have been laying over better than this, though, I would think. But you got a decade of differences here. Okay, yeah, one more. Oh, man. Oh, that... Okay, so here's something cool. It looks like they used the new scan for this swimsuit issue. Hey, here, let's start a rumor. Marvel Swimsuit Omnibus. No, but seriously, look at the colors. Like, I don't know if you can tell from here on the camera or not, but it all looks blurry and pixelated here, whereas this looks smooth and darker. Now, that's really cool. I wonder if that's the only one. Yeah, it looks like the swimsuit issues, the colors are a little bit darker on the new printing. It looks like a better scan, too. And honestly, the cards look like they're better scans. So maybe the extras are just better scans than the original one. So, oh, let's look at that image. There we go. Yeah, they're more vibrant, the colors, just a little bit more. Not too much. But that, as they say, is that. Now, if you're interested in purchasing this omnibus, don't forget to check out our sponsor, CheapGraphicNovels.com, your online source for collected editions up to 50% off retail price. Cheap Graphic Novels prides itself on excellent packaging, so your stuff gets to you in excellent condition, and they have amazing customer service. Check out their bargain deals for up to 90% off cover price. And for all you minties that are watching, if you're a first-time customer, don't forget to mention that Near Mint Condition sent you their way for a promotional credit on free shipping on your next order. Now, this is only for you U.S. customers. CheapGraphicNovels.com, your source for the hottest books with deep discounts, customer service, and excellent shipping that will keep you coming back for more. And that was the content, the page count, the build, and of course the comparison to the original printing of this particular omnibus. Let me know in the comments down below if you are picking this up, if you've never read any of this stuff, and this is your first time going in, and if you have read this stuff, where do you rank X-Factor Endgame? That's really the question here. But no, in all seriousness, I'm so excited that this book is coming back into print. It was one of our most wanted reprints last year, so I will be doing that poll actually here in the next couple of weeks for your most wanted Marvel Omnibus reprint, and we'll get that information over to Marvel. Again, thank you all so much for watching. Please don't forget to hit that like button, ring that bell for notifications to let you know when our videos are going live. And speaking of live, the amazing Amanda and I return tonight at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time with Was It Really That Bad? Masters of the Universe, as well as talk about some comic book movie news. So that is at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And a big, huge shout out to our patrons for making videos like this possible. And of course, all of you, thank you so much for watching. And stay healthy, stay safe, much love.